she is. She's pretty hardcore. She's a really good character. But again, she's got unique combat moves. She obviously has electricity, and we can take out loads of bad guys, which is always great. But what we're doing here is like I say, we're kind of breaking. Concentrate time. we're breaking in, like I say, just to break some bad guys out, to give us that bigger roster, because at this point in the story, the bad guys have twigged that something is amiss. But obviously, no one's going to believe the bad guys. If Harlequin and Joker came to you and said something was going on, you wouldn't believe them.
No, you
would assume that it's because something bad's going on. Like me freezing my own like party characters. See, this is what happens when you give me the controller. Right, that's going here. Livewire's going to just sneak through there. You know, she's known as Leslie Willis.
Right.
They're the affiliation she's got. On the right-hand side, there's like her bio. A
little bit of context.
Yeah, the first comic she ever appeared in, if you wanted to go and read the comic.
Gotcha. Okay, that's
Superman
perfect.
Adventures number 5 from 1997. And then all these things at the top here are the powers and abilities she has. So we're going to go out into the open world.
Okay.
The big orange ball is Apocalypse.
Right.
Which is a bad place in DC.
Yeah.
It's a great place in the game. And people are going to see, we've Lego Batman 1, we had a really small hub, which was basically Arkham. And the Batcave. Lego Batman 2, we did an open world Gotham. In 2014, Lego Batman 3, we did some of the Lantern worlds. And now we've actually got the biggest hub we've ever done for DC, because it's got here, you can see I'm in sunny Metropolis.
Yeah.
But as I go around and as I sort of explore, every kind of cool place in DC is in this hub. So here we've got a character called Golden Glider who can fly. The reason I want a flying character is so that I can get a little bit of height and show that we've got Metropolis, you know, and all the locations you'd expect, the Daily Planet, there's LexCorp, there's a nice, like, trigger point there that will actually take you to Apocalypse, which is super exciting and really scary. But down here in the shadow of Metropolis is Gotham. So we've put them together. There's a lovely cable car that links the two.
They go from the kind of the Art Deco to the kind of dark and gothic world.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, all the atmosphere will change, and you know, the weather and the vibrancy and the music. Everything changes as you move around. And down here, you've got all of the places you'd expect to find in Gotham. And it's a little bit scarier.
Yeah,
it's probably the best way. But all throughout, in obviously my little mini-map, phone on the bottom, there's just stuff to do everywhere. So if I bring the map up, this is my bit of Gotham, and then up here I've got my sunnier Metropolis.
Yeah.
We've got Belle Reve and a few other places here, and Wayne Manor and the Batcave, Amusement Mile. There's Arkham. This is a really spooky area down there, and there's a great Bizarro quest. But the great thing is, it's just a huge open world to explore. We've even got Smallville up there. So all of this area here, and you can go up a higher level. There's the Watchtower. There's loads of great stuff to explore.
Yeah, yeah.
But what I'll do is I'll kind of just give a scenic tour, and then as well, I'll show a few other characters. So there's Amusement Mile with some great gameplay down here. If I was to land, there's don't fall. Let's catch that one.
So even though this is a hub, what kind of, you're kind of talking about, I saw the activity markers on the map, what kind of stuff could we do even while we're in the hub world rather than going on a mission?
So there's all sorts of stuff that range from the standard sort of thing like races to like some intricate puzzles, some quests, some really quite tricky challenges which require a bit of thought, which is, you know, really, really exciting because it kind of just pushes people that little bit further. But it's just the vibrancy and the unexpected. The work that's gone into everything we've got is there based in fiction. So it's not just random gameplay. It's all based on comic books, movies, TV shows, cartoons, all little nods to DC. So everyone will love it
if they're
a fan of DC. You know, whether you're a fan of hero stuff, villain stuff, there'll be a little nod to everything. And all of these sort of areas like here, you can actually go inside the buildings. There's gameplay to open them up. The free levels will kind of encourage you to do that. I'm just trying to think where else I could go.
I think that the just taking off and seeing, I don't know, like the I think a lot of people don't associate this kind of scope and scale with, you know, the Lego games. It's crazy. And every time, I think we had a similar demo last year for a different game, you know, you kind of pop up into a flying aerial mode and it just looks incredible. And to be honest, I always thought of these as hubs rather than, you know, having being packed with activities as well.
Yeah, there's loads. And it wouldn't be right to have a villain game without having villain encounters. So there's actually random villain encounters that occur. So you can actually do random crimes, but you're doing the crime, because obviously it's a villain-based game.
Yeah.
There's also, I'm just trying to find, if I can find, I'm trying to find somewhere where I can be a little bit naughty, because we've got a system in place as well that if you actually, you know, do bad things, the police will come after you. So if I just turn around and try and, I'll just drive off down here somewhere. So like if I steal a police car, I'll have a crime meter that will slowly build up. And, oh, here we go. You look ripe for the picking. So I'm going to take your car, and then the more crime you do, your little crime meter will build up and build up and build up. And eventually, the entire Gotham PD will be after you.
Okay.
So it's just a bit of fun. But we've tried to really up the ante with all of the gameplay. Just to give people this great experience. If I...
Expecting you to be able to steal a car. I'm going to say, this is taking me by surprise.
It's kind of... It's one of those PG-13 villains.
Yeah. You know,
everything's really villainous, but done in a family-friendly way. Horrifically evil.
Okay.
But in our game, not only does she look bizarre, she also can throw sweets at people that explode. She has a rocket-powered Zimmer frame.
Yeah, okay.
She has goons that are knitted with like button eyes, and they're like really evil-looking, like Coraline characters.
Oh, yeah.
It's just so much fun. And like I say, yeah, there are so many characters, and hopefully there's ones that people really love, like Music Meister, who will sing for you and dance. And then you've got characters like Ventriloquist, who's one of my personal favorites, because, you know, you can sneak around on the back of the Ventriloquist dummy. He can also play a little bit of piano for you, and you can use that as cover.
Oh, man. Really begin, like, just a new appreciation of just how much work goes into not only, you know, getting all these characters and putting in your game, but just giving them the little details that are going to make finding it and unlocking them all so much fun.
Yeah. And the cool thing is, so we've got a huge roster already, but we've actually got, because the game's out on October the 19th.
Okay. Just next month?
Yep. On obviously, you know, and we're looking for everyone to go out and pick it up. But there's a deluxe edition you can get at Game, I think it is. And that gives you the season pass as well.
Yeah.
And in the season pass, we've got some amazing sort of character packs that dial into sort of DC's CW universe.
Okay. TV stuff.
Yep. Right. Yeah, absolutely. There's also a pack in there, a couple of packs of Aquaman the movie, which kind of give a bit of kind of context for the movie.
Yeah.
Zam. There's just some really, really great stuff.
Do you know
stuff.
I love it? And it's because when you kind of team up with with an institution like DC, obviously you get this enormous back catalogue to play with. But what I like is, you know, the TV exists and the comic exists and the film exists, and this is like an arena where everything just gets to play together.
Yeah.
Which you might not necessarily get to do in any one of those places. So.
Yeah, and for anyone that's like fans of the sort of different areas of DC, you'll see the little nods to everything. So if you are a fan of, say, the Flash TV series, you'll see nods to the show. If you're a fan of the DC Cinematic Universe, there's nods to that. Fans of you know, older animated series, there's stuff in there for that. So if you're a fan of anything DC, we'll have covered a little bit of it somewhere in there.
Right, Arthur, we are out of time. Thank you.
Okay.